Richard Prowse.
Would Elizabeth Taylor have been as famous, or would her the idea of Elizabeth Taylor resonate with us still had she not met Richard Burton?
You know, that they became a love story for the ages.
Because when I was younger, and sorry to interrupt, but when I was younger, I hadn't seen kind of Hot Tin Roof or any of these movies, but I knew all about them. And I would imagine, the idea of never having seen Angelina Jolie or Brad Pitt on screen, but it's unavoidable that you know about their lives, and that was the situation with them.
You know, the Burtons, as they came to be called, or Liz and Dick is what the tabloids called them, they were so famous in 1961 or 62 when they were in Rome making Cleopatra. They were so famous that at the same time John Glenn was making his Orbit of the Earth, and their scandal was going on, many tabloids chose to go with Liz and Dick on the front page and put John Glenn on page two. That's just how much interest there was there. So, you know, that's that kind of fame was unprecedented. And I think in many ways, Richard Burton pushed Elizabeth Taylor. He pushed her to do Virginia Woolf. And so artistically, creatively, he pushed her. But I think we also began to see the passionate side of Elizabeth Taylor. She could have hid in there, could have been a big scandal about that, but she stood up and said, "Listen, I'm sorry that people may have been hurt." Richard, both she and Richard Burton were married. Mm-hmm. So, she stood up and instead of apologizing, they were honest about their relationship. And I think people responded well to that.
Yeah. It's funny because to sort of jump backwards a little bit, when you're talking about how she liked a life of luxury, I was thinking of the story in here with Ernest Lehman, and she was just like shamelessly dropping hints about, you know, the emerald necklaces that she wanted.
Yes.
And yet people didn't turn off on her.
No. That's what's so, what I found so remarkable about her. My last book was on Katharine Hepburn, which was a very different story about fame. And it was about creating a public image and living behind that image. Right. Whereas with Elizabeth Taylor, put this very honest, very authentic creation out there, which actually turns out to be authentic and actually turns out to be the real self of Elizabeth Taylor. You know, rather than looking at the public and saying, "What do they want from me?" she made us want to buy what she already had to sell.
Right.
And she did that by not being arrogant, by not being putting on airs. She did it by a true authenticity.
Well, it's interesting because you also have to wonder. I mean, in the book, you talk about kind of a Hot Tin Roof, what she's wearing.
Oh, the slip.
Made her a very big star.
Oh, yes, right. Oh, definitely.
And I just wonder, had she not looked like that? Had she not looked like Elizabeth Taylor?
Yeah.
It might have been a different story.
It might have been a different story because, you know, the Elizabeth Taylor's looks from the time she was a little girl served her very, very well.
Someone says in the book here something like, she was only 13, but man. That's inappropriate.
The story goes, they were making Jane Eyre. She has a small part, she's a little girl, and Orson Welles is watching her shoot the scene, and he's mesmerized, and he turns to his assistant and says, "Remind me to be around when she grows up," you know, because he just knew that this little girl was going to be gorgeous when she grew up.
Wow.
Yeah.
What was your attraction to Elizabeth Taylor? When did you decide to spend, I would guess, a couple of years at least of your life working on a book about it?
You know, I have to actually say it was my editor's idea, because after I did my book on Katharine Hepburn, you know, he said, "Let's keep exploring this idea of fame." And he said, "What better model to use to explore stardom than Elizabeth Taylor?" And at first I was a little reluctant because I've been, 15,000 books on Elizabeth Taylor. But when he said to me, "Let's call it How to Be a Movie Star," the light went off in my head, and I said, "Okay, I think I can tell a story that's a little bit different here, that kind of gets behind the scenes and explains how she did it, and rather than just kind of chronicling the same old story, to kind of look at it in context and see it, the broader picture. All of those marriages, all of those health crises, while real enough, served her very well, and the people around her perfected the art of using these personal experiences to create a star public image."
Well, it's interesting because she, you know, in the early part of her career, well, for most of her career, actually, she was managed by a studio, and her image would have been, I love the idea that you have to grow, 3 or 4 inches,
and
they would say, well, she ate a big breakfast every day, and she grew four
and
inches.
She grew. Yeah.
Just the kind of, kind of nonsensical kind of story right. that would pop up in Hedda Hopper's column or, exactly. or that kind of thing. But beyond that, though, I mean, she really kind of set the template, though, for living a life in public that still is adhered to today.
Every star who has come since, whether it be Madonna or Britney or whoever, has taken a page from her book.
Yeah. Whether they know it or not,
exactly. Yeah. They've none of them have done anything that Elizabeth didn't do first. You know, she kind of took what she had learned at MGM in the very controlled studio system and took it into a different kind of Hollywood, the new Hollywood, where you had to pretty much manage your own career and you had to create an interest in yourself beyond your movies. And she learned how to do that very, very well. And you're right. Everybody since has attempted to follow it.
Because before her, you know, I think back to people who were enormous stars. Charlie Chaplin was probably the most famous person in the world.
Right.
You know, Fatty Arbuckle for his time was one of those people.
Right.
But they're, you didn't know anything about their personal lives.
Right, right.
And in some cases, probably just as well. That's what they were trying to keep that under wraps. But she was much more open about that.
Well, the personal lives in the studio system were manufactured.
Exactly.
I mean, Joan Crawford, the perfect mother.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, these stories came up, and they tried that a little bit with Elizabeth. I mean, there were some fan magazine articles in the late 40s and the 50s where they said, you know, she's just a simple girl. You know, she just wants to get married and have a happy little family in some simple little house. Nobody believed it because it just was so absurd. Nobody believed that. And so that stopped. And Elizabeth, you know, very to her credit, eventually started saying, you know, she says very famously, I never pretended to be an ordinary housewife.
Right.
Richard Krauss.